may not realize it, but you just witnessed the creation of all the elements. Bang. The Big Bang only made all the helium. These rocks are slippery as hell.
The Earth and stuff. The Earth and stuff about the Earth and stuff. The Earth and stuff about the Earth and stuff. The Earth and stuff about the Earth and other things.
You know, some of science's most interesting and complicated stories are the result of trying to answer a seemingly simple question. And I've got one such question for you today. Why is the night sky so dark? I mean, think about it for a second. If the universe is infinite, if there are an infinite number of stars and galaxies, then why don't I see a star at every position in the night sky? Why can't I point a telescope anywhere in the night sky and see a star?
This is Olber's paradox. For an observer gazing upon an infinite universe full of infinite stars, every single possible line of sight will eventually intersect with a star.
Well, this is a paradox that plagued astronomers in the 1800s. And let's consider for a second a couple of their proposed solutions to this problem. Now, the first is maybe the universe isn't infinite at all, but rather it's finite. That the dark spots in the night sky represent some void at the end of the universe, beyond which there are no stars. Now, the problem with this is, you know, gravity. If the universe is finite, then why isn't all the mass in one spot? You see, the same gravity that prevents me from dunking a basketball is the same gravity that causes our Earth to orbit the sun, which is the same gravity that causes stars to congregate in galaxies. So why aren't all the galaxies just like running into each other, and why isn't everything trying to contract into one spot? The second possibility is that there's some kind of cosmic fog that's obscuring light from the most distant stars. Now, the problem with this is, if there is some kind of cosmic fog or dust, why doesn't it seem to have any impact at all at the, you know, medium range or short range stars? It only impacts the furthest away from us. Well, about a decade later, in 1927, a Belgian guy named Georges proposed a solution. He suggested that the galaxy was born from an explosion of a cosmic egg. And at the time, he didn't get much attention for this. But just 2 years later, a guy named Edwin proved him right. So the night sky is dark for two reasons. First, light from the most distant stars is so faint we can't see it with our eyes. Our eyes aren't sensitive enough. So in the early 90s, human beings put the most expensive, most advanced, most sensitive telescope ever created at the time into space and named it after our boy Edwin. And in 1995, they decided to point that telescope at the darkest region of space they could find and push record. And this is what they saw. Thousands upon thousands of galaxies previously unseen by human eyes. Now, the night sky is dark for another reason. And that's because stars even further than the ones they saw in 1995, those stars, so far away from us, are moving so fast that the light coming from those stars has shifted outside the visible range. You see, this is because of the Doppler effect. Now, if you've ever been in a city and heard a police car go by with its siren on, you've heard the Doppler effect. This is because sound is a wave. And you see, light behaves like a wave too.
Now, before we go any further, allow me to explain light as a wave. If you've heard this before or don't want to hear it now, skip ahead. We've all seen a rainbow. A rainbow is the result of pure white light passing through a prism, in this case, a cloud of water droplets. You see, the pure white light is actually a combination of several different frequencies of light. When a wave passes through one medium into another, say a wave of light from air into a piece of glass, its speed changes ever so slightly. How much it changes is dependent on the wave's frequency. Because visible light is a combination of many different frequencies, each one of those individual frequencies changes slightly differently. The result is a rainbow. This is the visible light spectrum. On one side, we have red light, and on the opposite side, we have violet light. These colors are different frequencies of visible light. Think of red light as the base of visible light, while the purple is the treble. Red light has a longer wavelength and lower frequency, while violet light has a shorter wavelength and higher frequency. Just beyond the violet light is ultraviolet, or UV, which the human eye cannot see. Just beyond the red is infrared, or IR, which the human eye can also not see. Now, consider a source of pure white light. The source begins to move at near the speed of light from left to right. The observer on the left will observe the light as slightly red. This is called redshifted. The observer on the right will observe the light as slightly blue. This is called blue shifted. This is the Doppler effect, the very same Doppler effect you hear when a car horn passes you on the street. When we point our telescopes at distant galaxies in the night sky, the further away from us those galaxies are, the more redshifted they appear.
So you see, the stars that are moving away from us the fastest also happen to be the furthest away from us, and their light has shifted into the infrared. And human eyes can't see infrared. So about a decade after the 1995 discovery, scientists pointed an upgraded Hubble telescope at the darkest region of space they could find and zoomed even further out, and turned on the record button again. And this is what they saw. Even more galaxies still. You see, this observation that the further away from us a galaxy is, the faster away from us it's moving, is an important one. And it forms in part the basis of what we understand today to be the Big Bang Theory. Now, the Big Bang Theory isn't some cockamamie hypothesis we cooked up because it sounds cool, though it does sound cool. It's the result of numerous observations and mountains of evidence subject to peer review. You might ask yourself, this is supposed to be a course about Earth. This is supposed to be about geology. What does the Big Bang have to do with any of that anyway? Well, it turns out you can't build a planet or a mountain or a stream without the Big Bang. You see, to talk about the beginning of Earth, we have to talk about the beginning of everything. And to do that, we're going to have to rewind.
You are about to witness the beginning of everything, the beginning of all matter, the beginning of everything and everyone you know. This is the beginning of every love story, of every K-pop band and cat meme. This is the beginning of time itself.
Now, you may not realize it, but you just witnessed the creation of all the elements in the periodic table. Not in the Big Bang. The Big Bang only made hydrogen and helium. The rest of the elements are made in stars. You see, stars are element factories, and inside their nuclear furnaces, they turn hydrogen and helium into other elements like carbon and oxygen. They can turn those elements into heavier ones like magnesium and sodium and sulfur. But there is a limit. You see, a star can only make elements up to iron. Anything heavier needs a far more violent process. When a supermassive star runs out of fuel, it collapses on itself under its own gravity. But the resulting temperature and pressure is so great that it explodes in a supernova. It's in these supernovas that every element heavier than iron is made. All the gold, all the iodine, all the platinum, it's all made in supernovas. And that's how we know our solar system is not a first generation solar system. It's probably a second or third generation solar system because we have elements heavier than iron. So, we talked about the beginning of time. We made all the elements in the periodic table, and we covered about 9.3 billion years of history. Now it's time to talk about the formation of our solar system and our planet. But we're not going to do that until next week. If any of this material is new to you, or you haven't heard it in a while, and you had trouble following along, it's okay. No one learns this stuff in 15 minutes. You can always rewind, or even better, ask questions in the comments below. Also, there are links in the description to good resources for additional learning, if you're into that kind of thing. Thanks for watching, peeps. See you next week. I don't know what that is. I don't know why I do that.